Well, happy Resurrection Sunday morning to you from Farmington, New Mexico. We're in the studio again this morning, like we were last week, of Horizon Media Studios and Overcomers TV. Our Celebrate Recovery pastor, Chuck Reich, this is his setup, and wow, what a blessing to have such a facility available in a time when we can't meet as believers together. This is Resurrection Sunday, as we've already said, and what a strange day this is. In all of my life, and I imagine you could go way back, and no one has experienced such a Resurrection Sunday as we're experiencing today. The fact of the matter is that most all of man-made sanctuaries are empty this morning. But you know what? Not just being strange, but this day is also a glorious and amazing day. And I want to end with those two thoughts in just a little bit at the end of this message. This morning, we're continuing in Luke chapter 3, beginning at verse 21 through verse 23. You know, I struggled this week in thinking about this being Resurrection Sunday, as to whether or not we should just have a very focused message on the resurrection of Jesus. And but as I was praying this week, I come to realize that we need to continue with where we're at. And just yesterday, come to realize that this is the perfect message for Resurrection Sunday. And even though we're talking about the baptism of Jesus today, you'll see here in just a minute, I hope, that this fits exactly where God would have us be today, as well as celebrating the fact that the tomb is still empty. And so we praise the Lord for that. But in Luke chapter 3, verse 21, the Bible says this: "When all the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus also was baptized, and while he prayed, the heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended in bodily form like a dove upon him. And a voice came from heaven which said, 'You are my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.'" Now Jesus himself began his ministry at about 30 years of age, being, as was supposed, the son of Joseph, the son of Heli. Heavenly Father, I just want to pray this morning and ask simply that you would anoint us afresh. And I pray for Spirit-filled speaking, but also, God, we need Spirit-filled listening. And so today, Lord, I pray for any who are listening to this at any time. And just pray, Father, that you will speak to our hearts today as only you can. And we thank you for this day and for this message in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Last week from Luke chapter 1, the beginning of this, in the first of this year, from Luke chapter 1 until now, you and I, we've only gotten glimpses of Jesus from time to time. It began with, obviously, the very conception of Jesus that we're hearing as the angel Gabriel is telling Mary that she would soon be with child. And so we saw his conception, then we moved into 9 months later, we moved into seeing him born and lying in a manger. And then 8 days after that, we found him being circumcised as the law required for any Jewish male person. And then 40 days, when he was 40 days old, we found him being taken into the temple, being brought to the temple. And we found Simeon and Anna there as they were declaring the very presence of God has come into this world, rejoicing. And great testimony through Anna and Simeon was going forth to all those that were there in the temple that day. And then from 40 days old, we see nothing about Jesus until he's 12 years old. And we see that time, as we spoke about couple of messages ago, where Mary and Joseph lost Jesus, the very Son of God. They couldn't find him and looked for him for 3 days and going back into Jerusalem. And there they found him. And the awesome thing was, after 3 days lost, it seems, they find Jesus in the temple and he's talking with the teachers of the law at that time. And the awesome thing was they were amazed at the things, the questions that he was asking, and no doubt the things that he was sharing there. And so we find him as he's amazing mankind, even from his childhood. And of course, at that time, he was about to be bar mitzvahed. In other words, that he was about to become the son of the law and the law of God, the Word of God, his Heavenly Father. And he gave us indication that his whole life was wrapped up in what he said to his mother Mary there that day, that, "Didn't you know that I must be about my Father's business?" And that's exactly what he was about then. And his life in public ministry was that way. And his life is still that today, dwelling, living in the lives of every believer, those who truly know Christ as their Savior. Last week, you remember, we found John the Baptist as he was fulfilling the prophecies, as he declared from the book of Isaiah, when he said, "I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord." And he declared that that everyone would see the very salvation of God. And the salvation of God is still being seen today and believed and heard and trusted. And thank God the very presence of Jesus today is still changing the lives of people that will allow Him to change their lives. It's a choice that we make. He came into this world to love us and to offer freedom from sin, from the penalty of sin, and from the power of sin today. Those are the two freedoms that we enjoy. And thank God one day we're going to be delivered from the very presence of sin when we're in His kingdom and living with Him forever. But you remember John the Baptist in that day when he was crying out, "I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness." And the Bible said that a great multitude of people were coming. And you remember what John the Baptist called these people? He said, "You brood of vipers." You know, who's warned you to flee from the wrath to come? The wrath of God that would indicate there's judgment coming. And if you're still in your sins, then you're going to receive the brunt of that judgment of God. Thank God we don't have to do that. When you go to verse 21, though, today, we find here the actual beginnings of the public ministry of Jesus coming into play. And he said here, you know, all those people that John the Baptist had declared, "You brood of vipers." And I don't know why they hung around, but many of them did. I don't know who did leave, but if they did leave, they missed the blessing of coming into the kingdom themselves that day. Because when these folks, those who remain, the Bible said here that when all the people were baptized, those who stayed followed through with this baptism of repentance, that they were being obedient to the very process God was laying out for them and preparing for Jesus to come, obviously, but that preparation for Jesus coming, and let me just indicate here, that preparation for Jesus coming even into our lives to move in, that He may change us from the inside out, and that purpose for Him moving in is so that He can continue to live out His life in us, changing us, but also, and for what purpose? So that He can live His life through us and others get a glimpse of Jesus. Thank God today that God has always had a people, all down through the dark ages, through the over 400 years of silence between the Old and New Testaments. God had a people, and people like Simeon and Anna, and people that were faithful like Mary and Joseph and Elizabeth. And so here were those people that represented the faithfulness, the faithful to God in that day. And you know what? God's still got a people here. And I believe there's some of you listening today. And you know Christ is your Savior. And you know that it's more than just a head knowledge. But this knowledge of Jesus is not just a head knowledge, but it is a heart change, that God has transformed your heart. And you know that that difference is real in your life, because we can't be satisfied with and find joy in sin anymore. Oh, there may be momentary joy, you know, in sin for a season, for a moment, even for people who know Christ. But in the outcome, though, of that falling and giving into sin in our lives, that we find ourselves being convicted by the very presence of Jesus, the Holy Spirit of God, that's living within us. And so we praise the Lord today for what Jesus was doing back then, even through John the Baptist, in warning them that repentance, turning from sin to the living God, is something that we must do. And those people that John the Baptist was in their face declaring, "You brood of vipers! I mean, you bunch of snakes!" How many people would hang around for that message to be preached? And so we find that John the Baptist, those who remained, he baptized them. And then the Bible tells us somebody else shows up. And here's, as John declares at one point, he said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And so it came to pass that Jesus also was baptized. And you know, John the Baptist had a problem with that when Jesus came. I mean, he was literally saying, "Look, I have need to be baptized of you. And why would you want me to baptize?" And that brings up a good question. And that question that, you know, that if Jesus, why would the sinless Jesus, the living Son of God in the flesh, why would he submit to a baptism of repentance? I mean, is he not sinless? Hebrews 4:15 tells us that he was tempted in all manner like as we are, yet without sin. And here we find Jesus submitting. And I want you to know today that he came and he declares this. He says, you know, that he had come and it actually tells us in Matthew chapter 3 and verse 15 where Jesus is there to be baptized. And Jesus answered when John the Baptist questioned him, and he said, "Permit it to be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness." Jesus came in obedience to God. And in fulfilling this righteousness that he's talking about here, the one thing Jesus, the reason God became man and came into the world is that he could connect with us. And what greater thing could ever be done in the beginning of this ministry that Jesus connected, related to those that he came to save by submitting to this baptism of repentance. And though he was sinless and didn't need repentance, he connected with us by doing this with John the Baptist. And so he came and submitted himself to this baptism of repentance. But you know what? Jesus did more than just come and submit himself to repentance, to connect with us. Jesus went deeper. Let me share that with you in just a moment. Another thing, though, and this was kind of my aha moment, and in the questions that we'll post on Facebook and we send out to those who requested, and if you're not receiving them, we'd love to send them to you. And that email address that you see from time to time is a good place to ask. And so we find that in this, though, that my aha moment was this, that in that moment when Jesus was baptized, the Bible said the heavens opened. And when the heavens open, brother, you better watch out. Something important is about to take place. And what happened in this moment is the very fact that God, the Father of Jesus, he began to speak. And he said that you are my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Do you know there's three places in Scripture, and if you get those questions, you'll find that being asked. But there's three times when something similar to this takes place. At this baptism, at the transfiguration, and then when you had some Greek guys coming around saying, "Hey, we must see Jesus." And you find this same thing happening and how important these portions of Scripture are. And I encourage you to look those up, especially if you're doing those questions. It'd be a good time to do that. But you know what? Jesus didn't just come to connect with us, but he went deeper because he not only connected with us, but he became a substitute for us in our sins. The Bible said in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21, "For he made him," God made him, Jesus, "who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Him. And so Jesus did more than just connect with us and to relate to us. But Jesus became sin for us so that when we stand before God and we've believed and trusted that Christ died for our sins and when He hung on a cross some 2,000 years ago, and yes, He was buried, and thank God He rose again from the dead. You see, these verses in His baptism, the beginning of this ministry, this is a perfect message for Resurrection Sunday. And quite frankly, any message about Jesus could be a perfect message, because you can't talk about Jesus with any substance at all without eventually getting to the fact that He died for me, He died for you, and thank God He rose again from the dead on the third day, just like He said He would. I began this message this morning by saying that on this happy Resurrection Sunday, what a strange day this was, because man-made sanctuaries are empty today for the most part. But not only is it strange, but it's also glorious. And glorious, why? Because the borrowed tomb is still empty. It was empty 2,000 years ago, and it's empty today. It was a borrowed tomb because He only needed it for the weekend. And praise God, He did exactly what He said He came to do. But not only is it a strange day and a glorious day, but it's also an amazing day. As empty as sanctuaries are, as empty as the tomb is, the amazing thing is this: the true sanctuaries of God are not empty this morning, and they never have to be empty, because we understand today that our bodies are the temple and of the Holy Spirit of God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 20, the Bible said that, that you were bought with a price, and therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. In verse 19, though, it told us that our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit of God. And so this temple in verse 20 of 1 Corinthians 6 is telling us that this body temple has a purpose. And that purpose is to glorify God in your body and in your spirit. Are you fulfilling your purpose today, that God has left you here? If this relationship with God through the blood sacrifice of Jesus Christ is real in your life, then there's been a transformation, a transaction that's took place that is the most powerful transaction to ever be experienced by anyone in this world. And all the changes that come as a result of Jesus moving in. You see, our body temple has a purpose to glorify God. And how can I do that today? Not by yourself, you can't. But this temple has a provider. And it's Christ in you, the hope of glory. And this provision that God has given through Christ in you is backed up by the greatest power known to man. Acts chapter 1, verse 8 tells us that you shall receive power after the Holy Spirit of God has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses unto Christ, unto Jesus. And so today, we have a purpose, and we have a provision, and that's Christ in us. And we have the power of God. You know, you really can do all things through Christ who strengthens you today. All of this fullness is real. All of this fullness you can possess, and it's Christ in you. Do you have that today? It is real, and it is life-changing, and all because the tomb on this day, 2,000 years ago, it really was empty. But you don't have to be empty today. To empty ourselves of ourselves, and Christ will fill us. I hope and pray today your relationship with Christ is bringing great joy to you. And in this time that so many are afraid, I hope and pray today that you are finding the peace of God that passes all understanding. May you be blessed, and ask the Lord today to know you and to know you in the fullness of His presence, in Jesus' name. Until next time, God bless you.